Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to this special webinar, Western Region Director Candidates Forum. I'm Chris Nussman, I'm Nina's Communications Director, and in a second here, I'll be handing things off to our moderator for the webinar, Steve O'Connor, one of our past presidents. But before I do that, a few notes of housekeeping for everybody. We are recording this webinar, so if you miss any part of it, want to watch it again, share it with other NENA members in the Western region, we'll automatically email you a link to the on-demand archive that's going to be hosted on the NENA YouTube channel and a PDF of the slide deck. And of course, the best voter is an informed voter, so please make the webinar interactive. Use the GoToWebinar interface to ask your questions of the candidates, and we'll get to as many of those as we can towards the end of the half hour. And with that, I'm going to hand things over to Steve O'Connor.
Well, thank you, Chris. Just continuing on with our housekeeping before we get to the candidates themselves, these are a few dates to remember. The online voting opens up on the 26th of this month and closes on the 17th of May. The election results will be certified on June 12th, and the new board will be sworn in on the 15th at the NENA annual conference.
Cool. And Steve, just one note on that. All eligible voters will automatically receive a link to their ballot on the 26th, so you don't have to request anything or do anything special. If you're an eligible voter in the Western region, you'll automatically get your ballot on that Tuesday, April 26th.
Thank you, Chris. Now, proceeding on, our webinar format will consist of introducing the candidates individually. I'll provide a brief bio for each of them and ask them if they have any opening statements that they'd like to make. And then we have a series of questions, about half a dozen questions for each of the candidates. I will ask them in turn. The questions will be in turn, and then they'll each have a chance to respond, and we'll alternate who goes first. And then, time permitting, if anyone in the audience has any questions, please use the GoToWebinar. There is a chat box available that you can type your message in, and if we have enough time, certainly we would be happy to get to those questions as well. So, proceeding to the candidates, the first candidate I would like to introduce is Pat Lustig. His career in 911 spans about 35 years, beginning as a telecommunicator, then supervisor, and finally division commander with the Jackson County, Illinois Sheriff's Office, where he spent his first 22 years in public safety emergency communications. From there, Pat moved on to become the 911 director for Jackson County, Illinois for the next 12 years. During his tenure there, he served as the project manager for the counties of Southern Illinois Next Generation 911 Project. And for the past 2 years, Pat has served as the Next Generation 911 Project Manager for the state of Oregon. Pat has also been active in NENA at the chapter level, serving as the Illinois chapter president for 5 years. Pat, would you do you have an opening statement you'd like to make?
Yes, I do, Steve. Just expanding on your comments, first of all, I'd like to thank everybody that joined the call today. As Steve has indicated, I'm seeking the position of Western Region Director. I am currently the Next Generation 911 Project Manager for the state of Oregon and have been in that position for 2 years. Prior to that, I was the 911 Director of Jackson County, Illinois for 12 years. During my tenure as the 911 director, I was the project manager for the counties of Southern Illinois Next Generation 911 Project. The CSI Next Generation 911 Project brought 15 counties and one municipality together in an effort to deploy a regional Next Generation 911 solution. The project was honored in February by the Next Generation 911 Institute, receiving the Outstanding 911 Call Center Program Award. prior to my position, as Steve had indicated, as the Jackson County 911 director, I spent 22 years with the Jackson County Sheriff's Department. I began my public safety career as a telecommunicator, working my way to supervisor and finally division commander. During my 35 years, I've held the position of vice president for the Illinois chapter of MENA for 2 years. I became president and held that position for 5 years. During my time as president, the chapter initiated a 911 goes to the state capital, which happens to be Springfield, fostered after the 911 goes to Washington program. This year will be the 9th annual 911 goes to Springfield. One of the accomplishments that I am most proud of during my tenure as chapter president was my work with the General Assembly in the creation of state statutes to facilitate the deployment of next generation 911. As in many states, statute prohibited the 911 next generation 911 deployment. Although the project took 8 years, there were many rewards. Most rewarding were the relationships developed with 911 professionals in the region and throughout the nation. North America's 911 professionals are second to none. As Western Region Director, I look forward to the opportunity to work with the current executive board in MENA's primary mission of serving its membership. Many issues still delay 911 professionals in their day-to-day responsibilities. Improvement in location accuracy, text to 911, statute revisions to facilitate NG911, and strategies that will foster cooperation between 911 authorities, carriers, and vendors as our country transitions to next generation 911. Finally, I would appreciate your vote as I seek the position of Western Region Director. I believe my experience with next generation 911 deployments will serve the Western Region and the membership as we transition nationally. Your vote is important. Please exercise your right to vote. Thank you, Steve.
Thank you, Pat. And now turning to Monica. Monica currently serves as the operations manager of the Grand Junction Regional Communications Center. She began her career at that agency as a telecommunicator in 2001, was promoted to supervisor in 2004, and to operations manager in 2010. She also serves as the Colorado NENA APCO chapter president, co-chair of the Colorado State Training Standards Committee, chair of the Public Utilities Commission 911 Task Force, and also serves on the board of directors for the Colorado 911 Resource Center. She is active in NENA at the national level, serving on the membership committee and participating on several working groups in the NENA development group. Monica, do you have an opening statement?
Yes, I do, Steve. Thank you. Thank you, everybody, for participating in the webinar today. As Steve indicated, I've been in the profession for 15 years, 10 of which have been in management of our center here in Grand Junction, Colorado. I've also had a lot of opportunity to serve in different capacities across the state and our region. Some of the examples that Steve highlighted, it's really been important to me in continuing the work that NENA does from the development committees and working on the PSAP operations committees and having an impact and sharing best practice models across the country. My first step into that was at the NENA TDC-ODC back in 2005, and it really motivated me to become involved in the association and then as a member to be active. The work we did on the National Membership Committee the last couple of years and really generating membership numbers across the country, unseen numbers that we've never experienced before in our association, has been really of really great meaning to me in how I can help motivate chapter members across my state and across the region. As Steve indicated, I've been serving as the combined chapter president here in Colorado. prior to us joining the two chapters in 2015. I served on the NENA board for 4 years prior to that. Currently, I'm working with, as the chair of our task force here in the state of Colorado for the Public Utilities Commission, we're working with our state legislators. I have experience working with our elected officials. Last year, I was successful in really putting together for the Western Region, partnering with the current Western Region Director, our ENP study sessions, and I believe the Western Region had a great influx of new ENP certifications due to the efforts that Lisa and I partnered with in 2015. I really feel there's a lot of opportunity for us to continue to motivate and energize our membership. I think that it's important to have a voice, to continue to have voices from those of us in the operations side of the house, to partner with the existing members of the executive board to ensure that, especially with the influx of our telecommunicator membership, that their day-to-day challenges, we're doing our best as an association to address those. I feel like I can speak from that experience. And I look forward to the opportunity to serve the Western Region. Thank you, Steve.
Thank you, Monica. Well, let's move on to our series of questions for the candidates. We'll ask each one in turn, and since ladies are first, we'll ask Monica to continue with the first question, which is, what motivated you to run for office?
Thank you, Steve. You know, really what motivated me and has motivated me for the last couple of elections is really helping to make a difference with our association's membership. I've seen and experienced firsthand how valuable the networking is, the participation in the working committees, and how important it is to continue to encourage the participation in those efforts. The association is making a lot of new inroads, again, like I spoke to on membership, and encouraging those new members to bring their experience, their special skills to all of the efforts, and how do we as NENA continue to grow our business model is something that's really exciting to me. So that was my motivation.
Thank you, Monica. Pat, how would you respond to that? What motivated you to run for office?
Well, Steve, transitioning our nation's legacy 911 systems to modern IP-based next-generation 911 systems should be our primary objective. Demands from our citizens to modernize 911 are increasing. Some 911 professionals are not sure where to begin. I'm willing to share my current and previous experience with transitional next-generation 911 deployments and assist 911 authorities as they begin these rigorous efforts.
Thanks, Pat. Staying with you right now for the next question, how would you inspire or encourage the growth of the association?
Well, I will work with the executive board to improve the value of NENA to its membership. Value starts with a strong foundation. I will work with the board to see that NENA's objectives align with the issues that are important to its members. Publishing best practices and lessons learned, as well as continued standards development, will help guide 911 professionals as they transition to these new technologies.
Thanks, Pat. Monica, how would you inspire or encourage the growth of the association?
Thank you, Steve. You know, one of the things that I would like to do if I'm successful in being elected as the Western Region Director, I want to continue to educate the chapters about the value of the membership. I think as an association, we've done a great job through the membership committee, through executive board decisions, and how we're selling a value or putting a price on that membership, but continue to educate about best practice models and go-bys, the ENP certification and the weight it carries in our industry, and speak to the human connections and the professional connections I've made that have helped me in my career and development, and how members can leverage that for their own betterment and development. We have to find a way to help them discover the intrinsic value. So we need to continue to speak to the variety of opportunities there are to participate with peers in their state, in their region, and across the country on those issues within our industry that speak to each of them individually, and get those people to get excited and become more involved in the association.
Thank you, Martha. Thank you. Continuing on with the next question, what are the important issues affecting the Western region? And as a region director, what would you like NENA to do to address them? Monica?
Is that for me?
Oh, I'm sorry. Steve, is that for me first?
Sorry, yes, yeah. Monica, if you'll take that one. And then the next question, Patrick can go first. So we'll...
You bet. Thank you, Steve. I think here in the Western region, there's a few issues that I could speak to right now. You know, California, in the mostly the Western states, location accuracy is a big deal. Arizona has the suit that was filed by the National Association of the Deaf, and helping them get text to 911, educating them on the minimal costs that there are to our agencies and the importance of ensuring equal access to 911 for all of our citizens. You know, and helping the Arizona chapter reaching out to their PSAP community to make them understand how little impact the cost of enabling that service really can be for them. In the state of Colorado, we're dealing with telecom deregulation and helping share information across the chapter presidents, the chapter boards, and as a regional director, I'd like to help facilitate some of that conversation. Information sharing is some of the best things we can do to educate ourselves on the issue. From NENA, from the national level, you know, coaching and educating each other on how to deal with our legislators, how to engage them, and then really each of us, I know the state of Washington is going towards legislation to standards for training standards for telecommunicators, then how can we share that information across the Western region to enable legislation in each of our Western states? Those are some of the issues that I know that we're facing. As a member of the NENA team, that's how I feel like I could facilitate those issues.
Thanks, Monica. Patrick, just to repeat the question for you, what do you consider to be the important issues affecting the Western region? And as a region director, what would you like NENA to do to address them?
Thank you, Steve. I believe adequate funding to support state or regional implementation of Next Generation 911 is imperative. I will advocate on behalf of 911 authorities that each state have a state-level agency with appropriate authority and technical resources for planning, coordinating, and implementing seamless Next Generation 911 end-to-end emergency communication systems. I don't feel that our states are actively involved in this endeavor, and I will help support that.
Thanks, Pat. Now, if you'll take on the next question first, it is, how would you improve NENA's value to its members?
Well, as I said earlier, the value starts with a strong foundation. Once again, I'll work with the board to see that NENA's objectives align with the issues that are important to its memberships. I feel publishing best practices, lessons learned, being resources for the membership is the ultimate responsibility of NENA to help guide 911 professionals in the deployment of new technologies, that being from text to 911 to next transitional next generation 911.
Thanks, Pat. Now, Monica, how would you improve NENA's value to its members.
Thank you, Steve. You know, as the separate regional directors, I think part of our responsibility is to help motivate and inspire and energize the chapters within our regions. And one of the things that I can do in helping our individual state chapters and its members find the value is begin to reach out to the individual chapters. I already have a pretty strong relationship with most of the chapter leadership in my region. Discover what their hot button issues are, find ways to work with the chapter leadership teams, ways that we can encourage membership participation and involvement at the state level, and then the national level participation, and the value will follow. You know, again, we have to find those internal buttons that we like pushed, and I feel that NENA offers a good deal of value, whether it's through member discounts, low-cost training, as compared to other professional associations. So I think, again, it's leveraging that relationship as the Western Region Director with the chapters that I'm representing and how to help them work their issues on state to state, and then how do we information share at the regional level, and then again getting that value and that participation down to the individual members so they feel like they're a valued member of the organization and that they're making a difference.
Thanks, Monica. Now, I'd like you to continue on with the next question as well. What do you see as the number one issue facing public safety right now, and what can NENA do to address or better address it? Monica?
Yeah, thank you, Steve. You know, talking about public safety in general, for law enforcement agencies right now, I think the biggest issue we're facing is the social misconceptions about law enforcement on a general scale as it relates to misconduct or corruption. You know, from fire services really transitioned from a traditional model of mostly firefighters, you know, really to now providing mostly EMS in their communities. And then really from 911 leg of the public safety family, educating the public on, you know, what happens when you call 911. You know, today's technology, consumer driven technology, this common citizen really does not have any clue, any indication of what happens on our end of the phone, inside our centers, the complexity of some of these legislative issues that are coming, that are facing us. And I think really from a public education perspective, from the 911 fork in the public safety family, NENA can continue to help both at chapter levels, at the national level, and in public education campaigns. I think really that's our best avenue of defense as we're migrating to this new technology from our legacy telephony network. So really for me at the national level, NENA's assistance in helping educate the public is I think from the 911 perspective the most important thing that they could help us with.
Thank you, Monica. Now, Pat, what do you see as the number one issue facing public safety right now? And what can NENA do to address or better address it?
Well, I believe that our citizens are using devices today, and our citizens have valuable information that they're not able to communicate to our call takers and then on to our public safety responders. Our standards have been complete and continue to be developed. However, not all parties are compliant with the standards, and without support from the carriers, the vendor communities, the best systems are just that. I hope to help foster a cooperation between 911 authorities, carriers, and vendors as our country transitions to next generation 911. I truly support Chairman Wheeler's effort to encourage PSAPs and 911 authorities to transition to next generation 911. I think that will allow us to have information that we don't have today to better serve our first responders and our public.
Thank you, Pat. Now, before we get to our last question, I would just like to remind our audience that if they have any questions for either of the two candidates, Please feel free to enter them in the chat window as part of the GoToWebinar application. And I think we might have a couple of minutes left after the last question that we can get to your questions as well. So proceeding on with the last question, I'll ask Patrick to answer this first. What would you identify as three of your strengths or core values that you would bring to the NENA board and ultimately to the membership?
First of all, my ability to coordinate things. Secondly, my experience, and then finally, my dedication to this profession. As you indicated and I have said, I have 35 years in public safety. It is rewarding. I feel that my work is not complete yet, and I would like to see this country transition and have the ability to take information from the people that have the information to better serve the people that we do serve. Thank you.
Thank you, Patrick. Monica, I'll just repeat the question for you. What would you identify as three of your strengths or core values that you would bring to the NENA board and ultimately to the membership?
Thank you, Steve. You know what? One of my first strengths is tenacity. No issue is too large to overcome. There are always ways to break issues down into smaller components and work through them. The second value or strength I bring to the table, I believe, is integrity. I do what I say and I say what I mean. I follow through on my commitments and I am accountable for my actions. And third, the third and final strength I think I would bring to the NENA board and the membership is teamwork. I've demonstrated that I work well with others and I understand the value of collaboration, leveraging one another's strengths for the betterment of the whole. Or the betterment of the project. Thank you, Steve.
Thank you, Monica. Just to wrap up here, if you have any questions again, please use the chat window to submit them to our candidates. And just as a reminder, all of the members in the Western region will be receiving an email with a link the day that the voting opens, and I would urge all of you to, when you get it, rather than put it aside and get to it later, take just a few seconds out to click on that link and vote for the candidate of your choice. Chris, do we have anything submitted?
Yeah, we have a couple questions here. First one, how do you see NENA, specifically in the Western region, working with FirstNet, and how important is FirstNet for you and for public safety?
Is that question for?
Yeah, that's going to be for both candidates, and Monica will let you go first on that one.
Thank you, Chris. You know, FirstNet's going to be extremely challenging for us in the West, not necessarily in the metro, urban metro areas like in Southern California or Northern California. But out here in the eastern regions of the West, I guess is the best way to describe it, where we have large land masses with little population. Colorado is already working with FirstNet as one of the leading states in the country and trying to ensure that we build out this broadband network to transmit data to our first responders. I think that 911 has to continue to be at the table involved in the discussions because we'll be probably competing for similar funding efforts because of the aging of our telephone network at the same time that FirstNet's going to be trying to build out their broadband network, and I think we have to stay in lockstep with them. But in the West here, I think it's even more critical due to that we stay involved because it'll be key to discover and figure out where to deploy the broadband network due to our topography challenges and the huge land masses with little population impact. So I think I think those are going to be our challenges, and there's no easy answer to any of it.
All right. Pat, same question to you. How do you see Nina's relationship to FirstNet, and speak a little bit about the importance of 911's connection to FirstNet?
Yeah. As previously stated, FirstNet is just as important as Next Generation 911. It gives first responders information, and I feel that when you give people more information, they're able to make better decisions. I think there are challenges with FirstNet, but I think that 911 authorities, NINA as well, needs to engage conversation, begin those conversations with those folks, because it will be an integral part of our public safety response going forward. And I solely support NINA's efforts to engage FirstNet in these discussions, how we can best serve our first responders and the public we serve.
Okay, thank you, Pat. And we are over our half hour here, but we do have two more questions I want to get to. So thank you all for giving us a few extra minutes of your time here. All right, so Pat, you'll answer this one first. How will you engage the vendor community in a greater way to assist, enhance, and achieve NINA's goals and objectives?
Well, I think it's mainly dialogue. I don't, we in this industry for far too long have depended, and not in a bad way, depended on the vendor community to tell us really what we needed. I think those times have changed. Not one solution fits all anymore. So I think it's just a matter of dialogue, engaging vendors, being part of work groups with vendors, being part of discussions on the deployment of new technologies. So I don't think we do enough of that. We're too dependent on our vendors for certain things. And unless we dictate what type of functionality or devices we hope to achieve in the future, there's no way for them to know that. So I think just better dialogue with our vendor, as well as our carrier community. Our carriers need to understand that that tariffs are a thing of the past, that we need to communicate and engage in conversations as far as having contractual type of arrangements for services. Not all services that they offer under tariff are needed. So I think basically just having dialogue with both carriers and vendors.
All right, Monica, the same question to you. How will you engage the vendor community in a greater way to assist, enhance, and achieve NINA's goals and objectives?
Thank you, Chris. It would be no different than what we currently do here in the state of Colorado. You know, we recognize our vendors and our carriers as our partners. I happen to agree a lot with what Pat said. I think tariffs are a thing of the past. The consumer market is really driving the technology changes, and we really need to be engaging our vendors in, you know, what's coming, you know, what's coming around the bend, what technology, what new device, what new apparatus are they going to be selling the public that will enable them to contact 911 and ultimately public safety services responding to their call of need. But without having that dialogue, those relationships, and understanding that we're partners in this effort of delivering 911 to our citizens, we are failing the public. And I think, again, it's about developing those partnerships, ensuring that we're having the conversations, that we're engaged in the conversation at every level.
All right, and one last question, Monica, we'll start with you first on this one. How will you foster the working relationship between NINA and other public safety associations in the Western region, such as APCO?
Thank you, Chris. The same way I approach everything, you know, our profession is built around partnerships and collaborations, and really our professional associations are no different. And working together will only make us collectively better and stronger. And being willing to have open dialogue and conversations without allowing past harms or other silliness to interfere with those strategic relationships is really critical to our continued success.
Okay, and Pat, the same question for you. How will you foster the working relationship between NENA and other public safety associations in the Western region, such as APCO?
Well, just continuing that dialogue and that interaction that we have with them today. Obviously, they're an invaluable partner. I think our goals are aligned. We are actually both committed to public safety services, providing services to our first responders and our citizens. And I think that the relationships that we have today will continue and actually just become better as we continue to meet the challenges ahead of us and provide better services to our public.
All right. Thank you, Pat. Thank you, Monica. Steve, thank you for moderating this webinar. Everyone did a great job. We look forward to seeing one of you on our board next year. And of course, you'll be sworn in at our annual conference and expo on June 15th at the installation reception on Wednesday night. As you see on the screen here, the event is taking place in Indianapolis, Indiana, June 11th through 16th. More information at nena.org/nena2016. And just a quick reminder for everyone, if you're planning on attending the conference, early registration deadline is coming up next week, next Friday the 29th. So be sure to register before then to get early bird savings. We look forward to seeing many of you at the conference. And for everyone who's watching the webinar as an eligible voter, please be sure to check your inbox on Tuesday, April 26th for your link to the online ballot. Thank you, everyone. As I said at the beginning of the webinar, we'll be sending out an archive of the presentation, both the audio and also the slide deck, so you'll be able to share those resources with other voters in the region. Thank you, everyone. We'll see you on a future webinar soon or at our annual conference in June.
Thank you, Monica. Thank you, Chris. Thank you, Steve.
Thank you, guys. Thank you, Pat. Good luck.
Good luck.